Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar Reyes Academy. Displayed are the list of news articles taken for today's analysis and their page numbers in different editions of the newspaper. The link for the handwritten notes in the PDF format and the timestamping of the discussed articles are provided in the description box and also in the comment section for the benefit of mobile phone viewers. Now let us move on to the analysis of first news article. This discussion is based on a measure to curb stubble burning. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this discussion has been highlighted here for your reference. We are continuously discussing about worsening air quality in Delhi, and one of the contributing reasons for air pollution in the capital is stubble burning in the neighboring states, particularly Punjab and Haryana. Here, when we say stubble burning, we are referring to burning the crop residues, which could be the rice straw and the rice stalk, particularly with reference to paddy. And even though the Delhi government has taken many measures, for example, like a 7-point Parali Pradoshan Action Plan to handle this problem, still it is not yet contained. Now, as a measure to address this problem of stubble burning, Union government is testing one new technology that is called as torrefaction. Now, this technology is Swedish origin, or it is a Swedish technology. The technology is tested under a pilot project that is funded by the Office of the Principal Scientific Advisor to the Government of India. For this purpose, a pilot plant has been set up in Punjab in the National Agri-Food Biotechnology Institute. This project is being carried out as a product of the major announcement that was made during the India-Sweden High-Level Policy Dialogue, which was held on 2nd December 2019. Here, the major announcement was the agri-waste to high energy biocoal conversion, which is a pilot project established under the Waste to Wealth Mission of the Prime Minister's Science, Technology and Innovation Advisory Council, shortly called as PMSTIAC. This is the project that we are discussing. So the Office of the Principal Scientific Advisor, in partnership with Swedish company named as called as BioEndow, has set up a torrefaction pilot plant. And this plant is for the conversion of agri-waste or stubble into biocoal. This biocoal is made from unutilized crop waste. This biocoal produces 20 times lower emissions than conventional coal. Now let us see the expected outcomes of this pilot study. Then we'll see about the technology. The first expected outcome, or the first advantage of this project, is the improved air quality with reduction of crop residue burning. Then it will lead to reduced emissions as a result of using biocoal, which is a clean energy source. At least we can say it's a relatively clean energy source. Then generation of livelihood opportunities for farmers. This is because biocoal production creates new market linkages for agricultural waste. Next, the biocoal can be used as a clean energy input source in thermal power plants, also in households, for example, whenever there is a requirement of burning, or in some cases for cooking. Next, it will help in capacity building through technology development and employment generation. See, this is a new technology. If something is to be developed from this technology, there will be industries based on this, there will be employment based on this, there will be generation of jobs. And this will also result in improvement of soil quality. See, this is because stubble burning will now be avoided. And we know that one of the disadvantages, or one of the negative impacts of stubble burning, is that the loss of soil nutrients because of stubble burning. Now let us see about this technology, torrefaction. See, it is a thermochemical process. This involves heating of biomass in the absence of air at 200 to 350 degrees Celsius temperature. What happens at this high level temperature in the absence of air? Volatilization takes place. What do we mean when we say volatilization? See, it is nothing but transition of chemicals from solid state or from liquid state into vapor phase. So as the volatilization of biomass takes place in this 200 to 350 degrees Celsius temperature range, around 30% mass of the original biomass is reduced. See, this torrefaction is called as a near net zero energy process. This is because the 10% energy that is released in the form of a combustible gas is reutilized in the process. This combustible gas is also known as torrefaction gas. This gas is reutilized for pre-drying the biomass feedstock.
So what happens in the pre-drying step? In this step, free water available in biomass is evaporated from that biomass at a constant temperature of 100 degrees Celsius using the torrefaction gas. If you see the previous experiments around the globe, it shows that the efficiency of co-firing biomass in large coal-based thermal power plants, this efficiency is much higher than utilizing the same biomass in the dedicated biopower plant with 100% energy supply from biomass. Also, if we adopt for co-fired plants, there if you see the incremental investment that is required are lower than dedicated biopower plants, which are designed for 100% firing of biomass. Now let's see how this torrefaction process is producing efficient biomass. See, this process is based on simple energy mass balance. In the process, as we saw earlier, 10% energy is reduced and 30% mass is reduced. So the energy density of biomass increases by approximately 1.3 times in the process. So by this we can imply that the torrefied paddy straw almost exceeds the energy density of domestic bituminous coal that is used in power plants. So here paddy straw is the biomass. And we can also observe the gross calorific value of the two products. See, the gross calorific value is the total amount of heat that is released when a fuel is burned. The gross calorific value of torrefied paddy straw is 4,500 kilocalories per kilogram, whereas it is 4,000 kilocalories per kilogram approximately for domestic bituminous coal. Next, let us see about the capital cost or the input cost of torrefaction process and the cost effectiveness of this process with another biomass creation process known as pelletization. If you see torrefaction, here the capital cost is 3 times higher than pelletization process where traditional pellets are created. See, this pelletization is a process wherein simple densification of biomass happens, and this process involves shredding, hammering, drying and densification. But it is found that though the input cost of torrefaction is 3 times higher than making or producing traditional pellets, this torrefaction process is cost effective. How we are saying that this process is cost effective? This is mainly because of the high energy value of the finished product and also because of near net zero energy process of torrefaction. We saw that 10% of the reduced energy is reused for pre-drying, whereas 90% of the energy can be found in the finished product. Then the torrefied biomass has combustion characteristics that are similar to coal. And this torrefied biomass looks exactly like coal, and that is why it is termed as biocoal. And this torrefied biomass gives significant environmental advantages when we compare with coal and traditional solid biofuels. And this is because of the improved fuel characteristics of torrefied biomass, for example, like high energy density, low moisture content, near zero sulfur content. Normally, because of high sulfur content in coal, we can see sulfur oxide emissions from power plants. But this torrefaction process reduces the sulfur content of biomass to the tune of around 30-80%. And it also reduces the chloride content of the biomass to the tune of around 20-70%. So that is why the final product, biocoal or the torrefied biomass, is safe for the environment and less polluting compared to coal. And then this torrefied biomass has water repelling properties. And therefore, the torrefied coal particles are hydrophobic in nature. That is, they repel water. So this property helps in addressing storage issues that are present in farm waste. That is, the farm waste that are heaped in huge bundles can be now made into products with longer storage periods. And torrefied biomass are far less prone to degradation from longer storage periods and from weather conditions. And even after longer storage periods, it is found that the torrefied coal or torrefied biomass, the energy content remains stable. That is, even if the torrefied biomass had longer storage life, it was without fuel degradation. So this process helps us to convert farm waste into torrefied biomass through the process of torrefaction, which may address some of the important concerns of energy requirements of our country in the future. And that is one of the reasons why this project comes under the Waste to Wealth mission of Prime Minister's Science, Technology and Innovation Advisory Council. With this, we come to the end of analysis of this news article. Now let's move on to next article. This editorial article is focused on the state of our economy. The article talks about the reasons for economy's troubles, and it also suggests some of the possible remedies to address these troubles that are faced by our economy. The various matters have been discussed by the director of the National Institute of Public Finance and Policy, who is a former member of the Prime Minister's Economic Advisory Council. We are talking about Mr. Ratin Roy. Now, with reference to the National Institute of Public Finance and Policy, see, it is a center for research in public economics and policies. It was founded in 1976, set up as an autonomous society at the joint initiative of Union Ministry of Finance, the Planning Commission, several state governments, and some distinguished academicians. Now it is a premier think tank in our country with an independent non-government character, though it receives an annual grant from Ministry of Finance of Government of India and from some state governments. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article has been highlighted here for your reference. So far, in many discussions, we have discussed that our economy is in slowdown. In this context, recently you might have heard a statement made by Union Finance Minister that our economy is not in recession. So what is the difference between slowdown and recession? See, economic slowdown is a situation in which GDP growth slows, but the value of GDP decreases, or the GDP growth witnesses a negative growth. For example, when we say that GDP goes from 5% growth rate to 3% growth rate, an economy is experiencing a slowdown. Here you see that there is growth, but it is lesser rate of growth. Whereas in the case of recession, it will be negative growth, or that there will not be any growth at all. Even though many analysts see, many economic experts may say that a slowdown is not a recession. But note that in a slowdown, there may be increase in unemployment and there may be drop in productivity. Now, if you talk about recession, there is no technical definition of recession, but many economists, they use the definition given by a non-profit institution or think tank of United States. This institution is the National Bureau of Economic Research. It defines recession in a more broad manner. It defines recession as a significant decline in economic activity that is spread across the economy, which is lasting more than a few months. And this decline is normally visible in real GDP growth, visible in real personal income, visible in terms of employment, industrial production, and wholesale retail sales. In simple terms, we can say that an economic recession signifies a drop in GDP, whereas a slowdown is just a decline in the GDP growth rate. This difference is like the difference between a salary cut or a salary reduction and a smaller increment. In a salary cut, an individual's actual income itself is reduced, but in case of smaller increment, there is a drop in the growth of the income of the particular person. Here, when we say salary cut, we are referring to recession, and when we say smaller increment, we are referring to economic slowdown. But know that a slowdown usually precedes a recession. That is, a slowdown comes before a recession. But a slowdown need not necessarily lead to recession. That means if a country takes appropriate required actions when it faces slowdown, it may be saved from recession. In a recession, there is a general fall in demand, and this is because of drop in economic activity. Then inflation remains lower, or it shows signs of falling down. Here the inflation remains lower because, see, people do not have enough money to purchase things. Anyhow, the produced goods have to be sold out even at the rate of lower prices. This is one aspect that we can see during recession, and there is also fall in employment rate, or in other words, we can say that the unemployment rate increases. And industries, they resort to price cuts to sustain their business. As we told already, you know, whatever produced goods are there, it has to be sold out rather than becoming a mere waste. As a measure of damage minimization, there is low inflation, there is reduced prices, so that these goods can be sold out. In some of these aspects, recession is also similar to a depression. Now, with this background in mind, let's see the editorial article. The GVA growth in the first quarter of this financial year was 0.6%. First quarter, April, May, June of 2019. In the second quarter, it witnessed a negative growth of 1%. Here, if you take gross value added, it is defined as the value of output wherein the value of intermediate consumption is subtracted. The value added here represents the contribution of labor and capital to the production process. It is a measure of the contribution to the nation's economy made by an individual producer or an industry or a particular sector. That is, it is a measure of contribution to GDP by an individual producer or an industry. And we know that GVA depicts or portrays the situation of economic activity from the producer's point of view or from the side of supply. Whereas when the net tax is added with GVA, that is the difference between indirect tax and subsidies, the GVA becomes a GDP. And this GDP gives the picture from the consumer side or from the demand perspective. So the GVA growth rate was 0.6 in the first quarter and minus 1% in the second quarter of the 2020 financial year. Then there is a question whether manufacturing sector, wherein much of production processes are carried out, is very close to be in a recession. The author states that manufacturing sector is definitely close to being in recession, but it is for different reasons. Not because GVA is negative. This is because, according to the author, measuring a recession in terms of negative growth in two quarters is not a concept that is followed in developing countries, but a concept that is followed by some of the developed countries. Developed countries, when their economies are in a steady state, and recession is considered a departure from the steady state. Any departure from the steady state is a recession. Usually, in developed economies, they would have fully utilized their land and capital. So, for making growth possible, there needs to be improvements in technology and productivity. But there are no improvements in technology and productivity. But if the improvements or growth rate with respect to technology and improvements in productivity decreases or becomes negative, then the country is in recession. But what happens in developing economies is that growth is possible when there is increasing use of resources, for example, the use of land for increasing the economic activity. So in this context, the author agrees with the finance minister that in terms of conventional economics, there is a slowdown and not a recession. But what should be the level of GDP growth rate for a growing economy to stay positive? And this level is around some at least 6% or 7%. But if you see, for the latest quarter, the GDP grew by just 4.5%. So in the sense of developing and growing economy, the author mentions that we are in recession. And this recession is structural in nature. Then the author discusses about what needs to be done to make sure that the full year growth rate does not fall below 5% or it does not dip to sub 5%. If you take for now, just only one quarter has the GDP growth rate of less than 5%. So according to the author, since the recession, we require structural actions so as to take our growth rates to be consistently up to 7+%. If these structural actions are taken, along with some short-term actions, this will keep the growth rate above 5% for at least over a 2-year window period. So now let us see the short-term actions and the structural actions that are mentioned by the author. The first short-term action that is required is from the Reserve Bank of India, that it has to quickly increase the amount of cash in the economy, that is to increase the liquidity in the economy. Then banks, particularly public sector banks, they can use that cash together with interest rate policy so that they can provide easy credit to the clients. Easy credit is also known as easy money, as the name implies that it is the easy availability of credit or money. That is, in other words, we can say that there is no need to pay much interest to access the credit. So when there is increased supply of money into the banking system, this makes the money easily available for public lending with lower interest rate. Now, what are the intentions of this easy credit? It is intended to encourage economic growth, but you know, it also leads to inflation, particularly demand pull inflation, because when there is more supply of money in the economy, the purchasing power of people has increased, more money chasing less goods, demand pull inflation happens. But the next action suggested by the author is the reduction in RBI's repo rate. We know that repo rate is the rate of interest that RBI charges from its clients, that are banks, for the short-term borrowing obtained from RBI by these banks. When repo rate is higher, bank loans will be more costly. That is, when repo rate is higher, the interest rate based on which loans are given by loans will also be higher. So what we have to take care is that when there is an action to increase liquidity by the RBI, the credit should be made cheaper as well. That is why the author is suggesting for reduction in repo rate. These are some of the short-term actions referred by the author. See, they are temporary measures for boosting aggregate demand, both consumption demand and investment demand. Because on one side, the loans given at lower interest rate can be taken by people and that can boost consumption. On one side, these loans can be simply used as investments. But if these are the only actions that are to be taken, that means structural measures are neglected, that leads to inflation. And further, it will also lead to stagflation. See, when we say stagflation, there are three things. One is high inflation, then there is low growth, and then there is high unemployment. So these components of stagflation that you have to keep in mind to tackle the structural measures. So as a structural measure, the author calls for a skills and industrial policy. For example, if you take textile sector, we have a market for textiles, but we are losing that market to Bangladesh. According to the author, there is one reason why we are not able to compete with Bangladesh in this area. The reason is we are unable to locate textile factories in the states where the textile industries are moderately priced, where the textile industries have high volume capacity, and the states where the labor is also relatively cheap. In such states, we are unable to locate textile factories. If you see, textile factories are seen on high wage labor locations such as Tirupur and Gujarat. So author is suggesting to invest in North India and Eastern India, for example, states such as Bihar, Jharkhand and Varanasi in Uttar Pradesh. So because we have reasonably priced labor while we compare with Tirupur and Gujarat. And the author is mentioning that because of migration to various parts of India, the laborers in these states are reasonably skilled. So this requires structural action such as action in a policy, for example, skills and industrial policy. Now this is a complex policy making which requires political investment, political commitment and also political will. When we say political investment, it could mean two things. One is political will and the other is the tangible resources that can be committed by the government to take all these structural actions. Now, when we talk about structural action strategy, there are few other sectors which are very important to this strategy. These are sectors such as agriculture, housing sector, health sector, and even the education sector. If you take the agricultural sector, when we compare the states of Maharashtra and West Bengal, the farmer suicides are more in number in terms of Maharashtra, and there is much lesser with respect to West Bengal. So it is said that the business model with respect to agriculture sector in West Bengal works better than the business model in Maharashtra. Here the business model has to be in such a way that whenever there is an agrarian crisis, the crisis should not affect the lives of the farmers, or during agrarian crisis there should be alternative livelihood opportunities, or there should be adequate supporting arrangements from the government and the civil societies. And there is variation with respect to states in agriculture sector, because we know that agriculture is an entry in the state list in the 7th schedule of Indian Constitution. Therefore, the author is calling for the change in business model in agriculture, particularly in states, you know, where the crisis is more and where the impact because of crisis is also more. Now, if you come to healthcare or health sector, people who earn minimum wage, they are unable to afford the healthcare facilities. So the author is suggesting that there should be a business model that allows people to earn the minimum wage and use their earnings to utilize the required healthcare facilities. And, you know, the gap amount shall be supplemented by the government in a later period of time. That is, people will spend some percentage of money for the healthcare, whereas the remaining money which they are unable to pay in accessing healthcare, that shall be spent by the government at a later period. Now, this kind of a suggestion is very easier to say than to do, because it requires serious commitment from the level of government, and also the private enterprises and also the private entities have also to be supportive to work with the government in ensuring accessible healthcare with respect to this suggestion. So here the author is not suggesting subsidies or welfare schemes or giveaways, because according to author, it will not work as we do not have supply of medical personnel to deliver affordable healthcare at a large scale. Then if we come to housing sector, land is available with the government. So the question is whether the government is willing to use those lands for affordable housing, or whether the government wants to use those land to build golf courses and flyovers only. So if government is willing, if government is ready to carry out the political investment, if the government is willing, government expresses willing in the form of political will, it can provide affordable housing. So as a conclusion, the author is stating that the economic slowdown is an outcome of supply side constraints and not demand side constraints. Here, when we say supply side constraints, say if the government has already given the affordable housing supply. When we say supply side, it can be meaning supply of affordable housing by government. It can mean supply of quality education in government, so that it can mean supply of quality education in government schools, so that the population need not spend hefty 60,000, 70,000 or 1 lakh within 1 year for one kid in private schools, so that these amount can be diverted for consumption of other activities. Then government can give affordable healthcare, or it can have some kind of tie-up with private hospitals, so that the poor or the affected communities because of economic slowdown need not worry about accessing healthcare facilities. So when structural issues are addressed, the author feels that automatically aggregate demand will increase and then consumption will rise, and this will in turn revive our economy from the present slowdown it faces, so that the present slowdown will not precede a recession. Now let us move on to the analysis of next news article. This news article states that the Indian Ocean region is likely to be affected by tsunamis that are generated by earthquakes at two potential source regions. In this context, we'll be seeing about the potential source regions. Then we'll see about some important keywords that are mentioned in this news article. For example, Indian Ocean Tsunami Warning and Mitigation System, which was established by the Intergovernmental Oceanographic Commission of UNESCO. Then we will see about INCOIS, which is Indian National Center for Ocean Information Services. See, the syllabus relevant for the analysis has been highlighted here for your reference. Now, the news is that INCOIS is hosting a two-day meeting of experts in Hyderabad, and these experts are coming from different countries. This meeting is being held in the light of the Intergovernmental Coordination Group for Indian Ocean Tsunami Warning and Mitigation System of UNESCO, as this Intergovernmental Coordination Group has decided to implement a project that is funded by UNSCAP Trust Fund. Now, this UNSCAP is nothing but the United Nations Economic and Social Commission for Asia and the Pacific. Now, this Commission for Asia and the Pacific serves as United Nations regional hub, promoting cooperation among countries to achieve inclusive and sustainable development. It has 53 member states and 9 associate members. Know that India is a member state. Now, coming to INCOIS, it is the Indian National Center for Ocean Information Services. It was established as an autonomous body in 1999 at Hyderabad under the Ministry of Earth Sciences. So it's a unit of Earth System Science Organization. That is why it is also called as ESO INCOIS. Now, the mandate of this national center is to provide ocean information and advisory services, not just to government agencies, but also to society, industry, and also to the scientific community. This information is provided on the basis of continuous observations made on the oceans. Now let's see about the Indian Ocean Tsunami Warning and Mitigation System. See, it was established by the Intergovernmental Oceanographic Commission of UNESCO. This system was established as a response to the tragic tsunami that hit the coast on 26th December 2004 that have led to the deaths of more than 2,30,000 people in several countries that border the Indian Ocean. This system is funded by the UN ESCAP Trust Fund for Tsunami, Disaster and Climate Preparedness. It became operational in the year 2013, and this system has tsunami service providers in Australia, India and Indonesia, which are providing tsunami services to around 28 member states in the Indian Ocean region. Now, the news article mentions that Indian Ocean is likely to be affected by tsunamis generated by earthquakes at two potential source regions. So these are Andaman Nicobar Sumatra Island Subduction Zone and Makran Subduction Zone. See, this Andaman Nicobar Sumatra Island Subduction Zone is also known as Indonesia Subduction Zone. Makran Subduction Zone is off the coasts of Iran and Pakistan, and this zone is poorly understood because of inadequate data or inadequate researches. And during the meeting, the experts have stated that it is possible that the tsunami waves generated by Makran source can reach the shores of India, Iran, Oman, Pakistan and some of the nearby countries within few minutes with heights up to several meters. So therefore, this subduction zone poses huge challenges to the existing tsunami warning systems because of inadequate data with respect to this particular zone. So experts have called for the development of probabilistic tsunami hazard assessment for the Makran subduction region. If you observe this Makran subduction zone, you can find that the denser Arabian plate is moving down or dipping down or subducting against the Eurasian plate. Because of this convergence of Arabian plate against the Eurasian plate, this zone is potential source for the generation of earthquakes. If the magnitude of the earthquakes is sufficient to trigger the tsunami waves, then these tsunami waves will travel in all the directions. And tsunami means giant waves which are triggered by displacement of oceanic waters as a result of earthquakes or at times because of volcanic eruptions. Now let's see the other potential source, that is Indonesia subduction zone. Here the Indo-Australian plate is subducting or moving down against the Eurasian plate. This zone is known for high magnitude earthquakes that can trigger tsunami waves, which are also called as killer waves. And one such tsunami we have witnessed on 26th December 2004. And the source of that earthquake is near Sumatra Island of Indonesia. So better understanding of these potential subduction zones will enable us to learn more about these zones, and it will help in early tsunami warning system for Indian Ocean region. With this, we have come to the end of the analysis of this news article. Now let us move on to next news article. This news article is with reference to the reply made by the central government regarding the demand from various states with respect to the matter of transferring pending compensation payments as a result of the implementation of GST system. The reply from the central government is that the compensation cess might not be enough to pay for the losses because of the tax system. There are states, for example, Rajasthan, Kerala, Delhi, Punjab and West Bengal, they have openly stated that they have not received the dues for several months. While we have been discussing about various aspects related to Indian economy in recent days with respect to private final consumption expenditure, government final consumption expenditure, gross fixed capital formation, investment rate, all these things, one another important concern in the last few months is with respect to lower GST and compensation cess collections. See, the government has budgeted for the financial year 2019-20 that it will be able to collect around 6,63,000 crore in GST collections. But so far, in the first 8 months of the financial year 2020, that is from April to November, it was able to collect only 50% of the budgeted target. While this is with respect to GST collections, there is compensation cess collections for which the government has targeted approximately 1,09,000 crore. If you see in terms of collections, so far only 59% were collected in the first 8 months. So this obviously gives a clear picture that the targeted GST collections in particular and the compensation cess collections may not be able to achieve by the completion of 31st March 2020. Here, when we say cess, it is a temporary tax that is levied for a particular purpose. And the money accrued by this cess will be used for particular purpose. In this case, it will be utilized to compensate the losses that have been faced by the various states as a result of GST taxation system. Whenever we study about cess, we'll also parallelly look about one another term called as surcharge. Surcharge is different from a cess because it is an additional tax levied on the amount of income tax. It is simply a tax on the income tax. We know that the GST system got introduced on 1st July 2017, before which there were several discussions related to convincing various states to agree for such a system. And one important promise that enabled many states to join this initiative was the promise of compensation to the states for the losses arising out of GST implementation. In simple terms, the central government had promised compensation for any shortfall in tax revenue because of GST implementation and the time frame. In other words, or in terms of law, this is called as transition period, and this period amounts for 5 years. Now let's see some of the provisions that were included in the GST Act of 2017 to deal with the loss of revenues because of GST implementation. If you see Section 7 of GST Compensation to States Act of 2017, it states that the loss of revenue to states on account of implementation of GST shall be payable during a transition period, which is a period of 5 years. It also mentions that it can be such period as may be prescribed on the recommendations of GST Council. And the compensation payable to a particular state has to be provisionally calculated, and it has to be released at the end of every 2 months during the transition period of 5 years or such period as prescribed based on the recommendations of GST Council. But in news, we have seen that some of the states have reported dues in receiving the payments for several months. And which year has been taken as the base year for calculating compensation amount that are payable to states? See, according to Section 4 of GST Compensation to States Act of 2017, the base year fixed is financial year 2015-16. This is with respect to the compensation that is payable to states on account of implementation of GST. In addition to this, there is also a mechanism for meeting the loss of revenue to the states by collecting cess. And this cess is called as compensation cess. It is simply a cess that will be collected on some of the prescribed or select goods and services, or select goods or select services, or both, till 1st July 2022. And why it is 1st July 2022? This is because the prescribed transition period of 5 years comes to an end by 31st June of 2021. And the center has also created a compensation fund, and know that the compensation cess collections are deposited in this fund. So as mandated, the union government has the power to compensate the states on bi-monthly basis. So these are some of the information with reference to the analysis of this news article. Now, we'll be getting more information, particularly after the upcoming GST Council meeting, which is scheduled for the second fortnight of December. That is, it is scheduled to be held in the last 2 weeks of December. We have come to the last session, the practice questions discussion session. The term torrefaction recently seen in news is related to which among the following? New technology for soft landing on moon, physical property of metals defining their ability to be hammered, pressed or rolled into thin sheets without breaking. Now this physical property is called as malleability. One example we can say that is gold, which is a malleable metal. The third option, process for making high energy bio coal from agri waste. And finally, a method to produce biodiesel. We know that this is a Swedish technology, that is a process for making high energy bio coal from agri waste. And this torrefaction is a thermochemical process that involves heating of biomass in the absence of air at 200 to 350 degree temperature to convert the biomass into biocoal or biomass into torrefied biomass? So the correct answer for this question is option C. Now this question is with reference to the compensation that is payable to a state with respect to loss of revenues on account of implementation of goods and services tax system. They have given two statements and are asking which of those statements are correct. The first statement, the compensation payable to a state shall be provisionally calculated and released at the end of every 2 months period. Now this statement is correct according to section 7 subsection 2 of the GST Compensation to States Act of 2017. Now the second statement, the Goods and Services Tax Compensation Fund, which shall form part of the public account of India, is a non-lapsable fund. Now this statement is also correct based on section 10 of the GST Compensation to States Act of 2017. So both the statements are correct. The correct answer for this question is option C, both 1 and 2. Now this question is with reference to the Indian Ocean Tsunami Warning and Mitigation System. They have given three statements and they are asking to select the correct statements using the codes given below. The first statement, it was established by Intergovernmental Oceanographic Commission of UNESCO in response to the tragic tsunami of 26th December 2004. Now this statement is correct and you can eliminate option B. Second statement, it is funded by United Nations SCAP Trust Fund for Tsunami, Disaster and Climate Preparedness. Now this statement is also correct, so you can eliminate option C. Now UN SCAP stands for United Nations Economic and Social Commission for Asia and the Pacific. Now the third statement, the Indian Tsunami Early Warning Center, established at INCOIS, acts as one of the regional tsunami advisory service provider along with Australia and Indonesia for the Indian Ocean region. Now this statement is also correct. So the correct answer for this question is option D, 1, 2 and 3. Now this is a mains question in GS paper 3. Indian economy is in slowdown, not in recession. In the light of this statement, discuss the structural changes and other measures needed to revive the economy. Now, you may give 2-3 statements justifying the given phrase that Indian economy is in slowdown, not in recession. See, the main question is mainly about discussing the structural changes and other measures that are needed to revive the economy. For structural changes, you can mention the change in industrial policy suggested and giving special focus to skill development. And here you can cite the example of locating textile industries in the states of Bihar, Jharkhand and Varanasi in Uttar Pradesh, where cheaper labor or low-cost labor is available in contrast to high-cost labor in Tirupur and Gujarat. Then you can talk about changing the business model adopted in various states for sectors such as agriculture, health and education so that it will empower the low income groups to avail the basic services so that they need not spend huge money from their pocket for purchasing basic services. That money can be utilized for purchasing goods and services, thereby increasing the consumption demand. If we address this structural issue, then demand will naturally increase. Then the demand is expected to increase. Then with respect to housing sector, the government can provide affordable housing on priority basis with the government that is in its fold. These are some of the points that you can take from the today's analysis in answering this question. For other measures that are needed to revive the economy, you may mention about infusion of money in the economy by RBI, by reduction of repo rate, and this reduction of repo rate can be utilized by banks so as to provide easy credit on low interest rate to the citizens to generate the aggregate demand. So these are some of the points you can take from today's analysis. You can also use your own viewpoints and some of the additional points under structural changes and other measures for this question.
With this, we come to the end of today's The Hindu News Analysis. If you like the video, click the like button, comment, share and subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more updates and content on civil service exam preparation. We'll meet you tomorrow.